So I'm delighted to be here with you tonight. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Great. Okay. As the description of the show said, my focus tonight's not going to be so much on what we might think of as Civil War music, which is military bands, etc., but on kind of the echoes of that music, and including some veterans themselves who made recordings in the period of popular recording. We'll also look at the echoes of some of the popular songs of the Civil War as they were recorded in the early 20th century. So we're going to start with somebody who was a Richmonder, a native of Prince Edward County. His name was Polk Miller. Polk Miller was in the Richmond Howitzers during the Civil War. He was, after the war, a druggist here in Richmond, and I was talking to somebody who actually knows some of his relatives. They're still around. He was really interested in perpetuating some of the music that he had heard back in the pre-Civil War period on the plantations of Virginia. So the first piece I'm going to play you, and he was wildly popular. He played in Kansas City, New York City, New Orleans. He was endorsed by people like Mark Twain and Fitzhugh Lee. So a well-known figure. He also invented the sergeant's flea collar, he loved hunting and hunting dogs, which made him pretty wealthy and able to do stuff that other people probably couldn't have been able to do. So start our talk tonight with one of the probably the earliest recording of an actual Civil War veteran, Polk Miller, and the Bonnie Blue Flag on an Edison cylinder. Now this, as you may know, is a cylinder player. The cylinder here fits on this mandrel. We crank it up. So when you lose your power during those storms in Richmond, I'm fine. I've got my player, right? I wouldn't do that. But anyways, so here's a great anthem of the Confederacy that he recorded with a quartet called the Old South Quartet. On an Edison cylinder recording, this is called a Blue Amber All cylinder. This was recorded in Richmond in 1909. And there's actually a correspondence at the Edison National Historic Site between Polk Miller and the folks at Edison. They actually weren't quite sure that these cylinders would sell. And they had kind of a battle, so Polk wanted to get them out by Christmas, right? He wanted to get this out. It did. They sold very well. These are actually, you see them on eBay fairly frequently. This was a long-time seller for Polk Miller and Edison. So let's think about this. Well, let's stay here right now. One of the interesting things about this recording is that there are two verses that are left out. One says, just as an example, as long as the Union was faithful to her trust, like friends and brethren, kind were we and just. But now when Northern treachery attempts our rights to mar, we hoist on high the Bonnie Blue Flag that bears a single star. Why do you think Polk Miller left that one out? He was recording for a Northern recording company. Yeah, that would have been a pretty controversial thing to put out there at a time when you still had many Confederate veterans and Union veterans who were still alive at this time. Now, one could also argue that the capacity of that cylinder is only 4 minutes. And probably the whole song wouldn't even fit on a 4-minute cylinder. So they had to cut something, right? But it's interesting that he did leave those verses out. One of the things I want to point out, too, to you as a historian, when I see this, Virginia at last has linked her fate. You know the order of secession of the actually, this song gives you the order of secession of the various states. Virginia voted twice to stay in the Union in their quote-unquote so-called secession convention, which is why I call it actually a Union convention. It really was only the invasion or the threat of Lincoln to recruit 75,000 troops that finally tipped Virginia over. But Virginians weren't crazy about the idea of secession. And I think that's reflected in this song in an interesting way. Now, these kinds of patriotic Southern songs don't actually appear that often on modern recordings. And here we have to think about recordings as a thing. When recordings first start happening with these cylinders and with these discs, these shellac 78 recordings that we'll play you here in a minute, what do you think they were recording right off the bat, typically?
Dancers. Opera.
Opera, dance music, a little bit. They're recording
spoken word.
There's recordings of McKinley and people like that. There's vaudeville routines. Nobody had any clue that you should record folk music, the music of the people. Nobody had any idea that anybody would even buy it. So it's quite rare, actually, to find recordings like this of someone who's just a regular, kind of a regular guy out in the field. Now, Southern song, of course, that also appears extensively in the catalog of recording companies, not surprisingly, is Dixie. One could argue why that is, but we have to, of course, remember that minstrelsy was the most important first American form of musical theater. We might bemoan that fact because of its racist stuff that goes on in it, but it's incredibly important. You can't understand American 19th century music without understanding minstrelsy. Dan Emmett, one of the great early minstrels, was the person who said to have wrote Dixie, but there's a African-American family in Ohio, the Snowdens, who originally came from Maryland, who claimed to have taught that tune to Dan Emmett after they migrated to Ohio. And there's a great book called Way Up North in Dixie that tells that story. Because one thing that Southerners did share, they didn't certainly share the same social ideology, but they did share a lot of the same music. And a lot of the music we're talking about originated with African Americans. We all know that the banjo is an African instrument that's been translated into the American setting. So let's hear just quickly a little bit of a Kentucky fiddler named Doc Roberts playing a little bit of Dixie. Whoop, I got to start earlier. Some of you know this tune. What is it? It's a medley. I believe that's a Forked Deer. Yeah. Anyways, Dixie was a well-recorded tune. This is by, as I said, a Kentucky fiddler, Doc Roberts, a very fine fiddler, early fiddler. I would say even this tune was not recorded as heavily as a lot of others, but my favorite, and I wish I'd brought it, but I have such a terrible copy of it, it would be even worse sounding than this, is a steel guitar Hawaiian version. It's pretty bizarre. So So now I'm going to play you a Georgia piece. We have somebody who's worked in Georgia. This is by Gid Tanner and his Skillet Liquors. Gid Tanner and his Skillet Liquors. And I think you'll find this a rather interesting version of a union song by a Southern group. I find it rather interesting that a group of Southerners would sing Hang Jeff Davis from a Sour Apple Tree on a recording in 1926. Well, think about it. These guys are from North Georgia. You guys know the geography of the Civil War? Like, there's this whole idea that all white Southerners in the Confederacy, in the existing Confederate states, were all down with the Civil War. No. There are huge parts of the Mountain South where there were a lot of Unionists. That's not to say that they were for black equality or anything like that, but they were unionists. They weren't interested in the Confederacy. And there are cases like the Free State of Jones, where you had whole counties that were in active revolt against the Confederate government. So it doesn't really surprise me that someone like Gid Tanner and Riley Puckett, who's the singer on this, a blind singer from Georgia, would sing a song with that verse in it, actually. So I just find that a really interesting sort of take. So, of course, I knew this as, of course, a very different words to this song. I'm from New Hampshire, and my grandmother used to sing this song with the correct words to it. So it was kind of fun when I found this version. So I want to go back to Polk Miller's backup band, the Old South Quartet, and talk a little bit about African-American music during the Civil War. So this, I understand for some of you, may seem very offensive way to put this, but this is how Polk Miller advertised his group, the Old South Quartet. Genuine Negroes. They look, act, and sing like the old times. Well, what the heck does that mean? Well, what it meant for Polk Miller, as he describes in this text, it's really fascinating, actually. He says, on the one hand, it's not the Fisk Jubilee Singers, or the Hampton Institute Quartet exist. That's music that's been, as a professor of Virginia Union, I love this term used, concertized. These are spirituals that have been created, made into art music, basically. Nothing wrong with that. Some of it is absolutely beautiful. Hampton Quartet, Fisk, beautiful recordings. I have many of their 78s. But what Polk Miller is saying, it's not that fancied up stuff. And it's not the minstrel blackface stuff. This is really offensive. This is the real deal, is what he's saying to his audience, that this is really what the antebellum African-American sound was. Well, we can all argue about whether that he was the person to be the arbiter of that idea. But I do want you to play you a little bit of a cylinder of the Old South Quartet without Polk Miller. This was a very popular song called The Laughing Song.
And this year?
This is, again, 1909. And there was another group that had already recorded from Virginia called the Dinwiddie Colored Quartet. In fact, by this time, the Fisk Group might have also have recorded. Let's play the first track of the CD next. So it's just a little bit of the Old South Quartet. They recorded in 1909. They also recorded by themselves in 1928 for the QRS label. So this is the beginnings of this black quartet tradition, bass, vocal, that eventually is going to morph into what we would call the Jubilee style with the Golden Gate Quartet and then doo-wop. This is a very, very early version of it. So we have to ask the question, what relationship does this have to the music of enslaved people in the Civil War period and just post-Civil War? Well, let's listen to, and this is so rare that there's no copies of this. This is at the Library of Congress. But it's so important, I want to play it for you. It's a recording by a group of former slaves in Petersburg made in the 1930s during the WPA period, when you know that writers were going out, people were going out documenting African-American life, particularly the life of former slaves and what their experience was. So this is them doing The Slavery Chained Unbroke at Last. You can imagine that would be quite a bit of an issue if a white person approached you, you were in your 80s or 90s, and wanted to talk to you about slavery. But Susie R.C. Bird's, her narratives are very different because, of course, she was from that community. She knew these people. She knew their experience, at least being a descendant. So it's a really, really amazing story. No one's ever done a biography of her, but somebody should. She's really a remarkable person. B-Y-R-D, just as, and Senator, oh, God, don't even want to think about that. the other way that the Civil War is important to the documentation of African-American music is that during the war itself, as you had what were called contrabands, people who were running out away from slavery into the Union lines at places like Fort Monroe, whites, soldiers, and others who were hearing that music, they're singing, the music of enslaved people, became fascinated with it. So in 1862, the first written musical composition of a former slave song is published in Boston. And in 1867, you have the first great compilation of these songs called Slave Songs of the United States. And includes a lot of Virginia material. It's a very, very important document. So the Civil War, in many ways, exposes Northern people who are coming to work during Reconstruction, who are in the South because of the war itself, to this music, and they're fascinated by it. And they start to document it. And of course, we do have some very famous touring groups. Most of these groups were established to raise money for their institutions. So if you go to Hampton and see some of the early buildings, many of those were funded through the travel of the Hampton colored students. As it says here, they would be going to Europe, to the North, raising funds for their school, just as the Fisk Jubilee Singers did as well. Let me play you one recording that I think reflects probably, as again, on 78, as close as we might come to that earlier sound. And this is a group that, unfortunately, we know absolutely nothing about. No one's ever been able to find out anything about the Virginia Female Jubilee Singers. And it's actually kind of an unusual record in that it is women. Most of the recording being done in this period is of male quartets and groups. This is actually kind sounds like a mixed quartet, but you never know. These have no lead-in groove, so you have to be precise. It's kind of curious we know nothing about this group. They actually made about five records in this really early, too. This is 1921, I believe. And this gives us, and that's important. So about in the early 20s, all of a sudden, these record companies started to get the idea that this folk music would actually sell. And we'll tell that story a little bit through talking about a couple of the Civil War, another couple of Civil War veteran bands that performed. This was an interesting one for me, being a Yankee, in that it really points to this notion of reconciliation between white Northerners and Southerners in the late 19th century. So Reconstruction's going on. As you all know, Reconstruction's a very difficult period, filled with a lot of violence, the Klan, struggle for black rights. And there's a point at which different historians will tell you different dates for that, when finally, in my view at least, part of the problem is that white Northerners just say, we're done with this. The Civil War's over, the Union's back together. You Southerners do what you need to do. And that, of course, leads to what? Jim Crow and lynching and lots of other things, unpleasant things. But among white soldiers of the Civil War, there's this reconciliation period where they basically say, they come to this agreement. This is how my father thought. Lee was a great man, right? We fought bravely. It was the war of brothers against brother. That was the mentality that shaped him right up until the time around when I came along. And this really points to that. This band is made up of ex-Confederates and Union soldiers. And that was the model they were operating on. Three Boys in Blue, Two Sons of Dixie is the headline. These guys played all kinds of reunions, both of Union and Confederate soldiers, all across the South and the North. Very interesting. I'm going to play you a tune by Colonel Patty, who's the guy in the middle, and then we'll talk a little bit about him. So we're going to play his Old Money Musk. Money Musk is a really well-known song, particularly among northern fiddlers. Not so much among southerners, there's few recordings of it. It's also one of the tunes that Jefferson had in his manuscript music notes, so he knew it. It's actually originally a Scottish tune. It's actually got calls. That's a good point. This is all dance music. So a little of Colonel Patty. It was very common in the North to play with a piano as your backdrop. Not so much in the South, where the banjo prevailed, not surprisingly. So who was Colonel Patty and the old soldier fiddlers? I bought this on eBay not too long ago. One of his postcards. It says, we are going to hear the fiddlers. Can you read that there?
This afternoon,
yes. So she's writing from, I believe the postcard is Battle Creek, Michigan, is where it's coming from, and writing back to somebody in Columbia, Missouri. So one of the things that I think is interesting about Colonel Patty, he wasn't a colonel. During the war, he was an enlisted man. And, there was a certain amount of rank inflation that happened after the war, where everybody seemed to have become colonels and generals and everything else. These guys were really almost a vaudeville act, and they traveled all over the place. He was a member of the Iron Brigade, a very, very famous unit in the Civil War, not to diminish his actual service. They played everywhere, as you can see. Here they are at Gettysburg at the reunion in 1913. And here they are at the soldiers' home here in Richmond in 1912. So these guys really got around. But I do think that notion of reconciliation is really what this is all about. Again, we've talked earlier about this whole notion of minstrelsy as a really important part of the story we're telling here. Sam Sweeney and his brother, more famous brother, Joel Walker Sweeney, learning the banjo from African Americans and performing it. Sam Sweeney becoming basically the house banjo player for Jeb Stuart during the Civil War. Polk Miller definitely picks up on that whole Confederate mythos in his shows. One of the things I didn't say about Polk Miller that's actually fascinating is he has to give up traveling and performing with the Old South Quartet in about 1911 because people in the South won't tolerate an interracial, as they would perceive it, act. So as conservative and nostalgic as Polk Miller may be about what he perceives to be what he's doing, it's during the age of Jim Crow, he can't even do that. I love this image of this Civil War band. It actually reflects very well the classic kind of setup of a minstrel band on the stage of New York or Philadelphia. And here you see another good example of that with the Virginia Serenaders. But one interesting thing, if you go back through the ex-slave narratives, you see descriptions of exactly this of these kinds of bands in slave narratives. So the plantation band of the pre-Civil War South did, in fact, consist of banjos, tambourines, fiddles, bones, instruments we associate that obviously were appropriated, if you will, culturally by the minstrel performers like Sweeney. So So, now we're going to go out to Texas and Oklahoma, and we're going to hear from a couple fiddlers who came in 1922 to a major reunion here in Richmond of Confederate veterans. Of course, 1922, think about that in terms of how long has it been since the Civil War ended. Most of these soldiers are getting pretty long in the tooth, right? So they have a big event here. Eck Robertson, son of a Confederate veteran. Henry Gilliland, who is he is a Civil War veteran, born in Oklahoma, but in Oklahoma Territory, I should say. It's not even a state yet, but moves to Texas. And they record, the great story is that, so they're down in Richmond. They perform for the veterans at the Jefferson Hotel, where one of the big things was going on. This wonderful badge from that meeting. And they get the idea in their head, well, you know, we're only not that far from New York. Let's get on a train and let's go to New York and see if a company will record us. I mean, this is like, it's kind of crazy, right? But they do. They head to New York. And as they say, the rest is history. They go in. The guy says, okay, get out your instruments. Let's hear what you have, you know, how you play. And they record them. And this is one of the tunes that they record together. I think many of you will recognize this tune. Come on now. There we go. I love that version. It's a beautiful, beautiful version. Notice, I think people play this song too fast today. That's not the way it should be played. It should be played like that. So think about this. Most of the recordings by former Confederates are not the Bonnie Blue Flag. They're fiddle tunes. They're banjo tunes. Why is that? Where was this music in the Civil War?
Around the campfire.
Around the campfire. Do you want to think about the other stuff? And no. I mean, that was where your social life and your buddies were. So this was the music that people listened to when they were in the camp and when things were better and they were enjoying themselves, as little enjoyment as they could probably get being soldiers in a brutal war. And believe me, I was in the Army, and you spend, you know, most of the time you don't spend shooting at people. You spend it marching or sleeping in a tent and with your friends, and that's all you got. So the fact that so many of these recordings and that these veterans wanted to hear at these reunions this music, it doesn't surprise me at all that this is what survived. So I think it's very fascinating, and it is. It's a beautiful version of the tune. So the irony of this is that this is 1922 when this happens. The recording gets made. Eck Robertson and Henry Gilliland go home to Texas, and a year passes, and it never comes, this record doesn't come out. And then in Atlanta, a rather impatient furniture store owner named Polk Brockman convinces Columbia to release a recording by a guy named Fiddlin' John Carson. And he pays for it himself. These companies have no idea that anybody wants to hear this. And it's a huge hit. He sells thousands of records in the first couple days. In fact, he has Carson get up on stage with a Victrola and play along to his own recording. You know, great marketing. So it blows up. And all of a sudden, Victor says, hey, remember those two guys from Texas? You know, where is that master recording? This could be good for us. And sure enough, they issue it. And this is probably the first true country fiddler who ever recorded. Wasn't the first released, but the first recorded.
Did these two guys ever realize that Victor had released it finally?
Yes, they did. Now, Gilland never recorded again, and I'm trying to remember when he died. It may not have been long after that. He was very old. Eck Robertson went on to record extensively and, in fact, lived quite a long time. And I'm sure you have, Harlan, met many people who knew him. Texas Shorty, who was at the Folk Festival a few years ago, great fiddler, knew Eck Robertson quite well. And he was so delighted when I told him to go over to the Jefferson and check out where he had played. He didn't know this story, which is kind of fun. So he did, and he recorded again. There are a number of discs, later recordings by Eck Robertson. By the way, the Arkansas Traveler, it was a famous sketch that had a narration to it that originated around the 1830s, 40s. And it's usually got some fairly hokey stuff. So it's a traveler who comes along, and he encounters this guy sitting in front of his cabin. Usually it's obviously set in Arkansas. And he says things like, tell me, where does this road go? What's the reply? Hadn't gone anywhere since I lived here. That's the Arkansas Traveler skit. And he plays in between each of these things. They play the first strain of the tune. Then they finally kind of reconcile, and the guy goes in, and they play the full tune. So it was kind of a stage thing. Another Texas fiddler who recorded fiddle tunes, this is going to be the second one on our CD, if you wouldn't mind, Clooney, thank you, was by a really, again, a very fine fiddler from Texas here that we're going to hear in just a minute. He was a captain, and he really was a captain. Moses Jr. Bonner is his name, born in 1847, actually born in Alabama originally. Then migrated to Texas, and very, very fine fiddler. We're going to hear a tune by him. I believe it's going to be Yearlings in the Canebrake. I wish I owned this record, so if any of you have it, call me. He was in Company E, 12th Texas Cavalry. Around one more time. Okay. So we're almost there. Yeah. So you can dial this back anytime. So there's a little bit of Captain J. M. Bonner, really, really fine fiddler. We're going to wrap up here with a few tunes that are just classic tunes of the Civil War that had some legs, that lasted for a while and were still being performed into the 20th century. Those of you who are dyed-in-the-wool Virginians, unlike me, will know, of course, the famous Carter family of Southwest Virginia from Scott County, the first family of country music, as they're often called. And I'm going to play you their version of a very well-known Civil War song called The Faded Coat of Blue. On the Montgomery Ward label. Yes, the big companies like Victor and Columbia would sell their masters to these store chains, and they would then resell them at a cheaper, usually a little inferior pressing, so that sometimes they don't sound as well, but this one actually sounds quite good, I think. We'll see. Thank you. Maybelle Carter with her very characteristic Carter scratch guitar part. Beautiful song, very poignant, very Victorian, right? You know, and this is one other genre of song that survived was these sentimental songs.
Like a Spanish-American war.
That's interesting, isn't it? The Spanish Brave. They translated the Civil War song to reflect the Spanish-American War, which is kind of interesting.
What's the original lyric?
The Nameless Brave, I think, is the original line. The other thing that's really important here that reflects a very deep Civil War sentiment, there's a wonderful book by Drew Gilpin Faust that came out a few years ago about death in the Civil War. And it talks about this notion that there was a notion of a good death in Victorian society and a bad death. And a good death was to be surrounded by your family and in the home. And these Civil War soldiers didn't have that. So most of these kinds of songs always talk about that. Look at this last line. So this was, you know, that was a really difficult part of the war for people. Sure. Sure, sure. No dear one was nigh him to close his mild blue eyes. No gentle voice was by him to give him sweet replies. No stone marks the lonely sod over the lad so brave and true. In a lonely grave, he's sleeping in his faded coat of blue. So, which is why you have so many letters of nurses and other soldiers who record the death and write back. One more of these sentimental songs, and then we can maybe have a few questions. We're going to hear one by a fellow who just died a few years ago. He was over 100, I think, Wade Maynard. Very, very well-known North Carolina artist. And we're going to hear him doing, well, he calls it We Will Miss Him. I think a lot of you, if you've heard it, you probably know it as The Vacant Chair. Again, very much in that Victorian mold. So, a little sampling of some music that sort of was shaped by the war. I hope you enjoyed it tonight.